Ruth chapter 4. Well, if you haven't been here for all of our Ruth series, then I think you've missed some good stuff, not because of what I've said, but because God's word is true and reveals God's character and his kindness. But I do want to summarize chapters 1 through 3 in case you haven't been here. The book of Ruth starts, it says that there was a famine in the land. In the time when the judges ruled, during the days of the judges — judges is a book of the Bible — and during that time, a 325-year time period, it says in Judges, it says that everyone did what was right in his own eyes. There was no king in Israel. And so there was a time of spiritual anarchy. In other words, it didn't matter what God's law had said. It didn't matter what God's word had said. It's that nearly every person in Israel did what they felt was right and what they wanted to do. Not unlike today in America, where we've thrown off God's authority and God's words, and many people want to do what's right in their own eyes. And it says that there was a famine in the land. And the famine, that it said that there was a famine, and Elimelech, a man named Elimelech, took his family, Naomi, his wife, and his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, and he took them to Moab. And whenever a famine hit in the land during that time, the people were not to just flee the land, but they were to repent. They were to turn from their sins. They were to put their hope and their trust in God. Because remember, God had given them this land. Where they were settled was the promised land. And so Elimelech led his family to go away from God's place, away from God's presence, and away from God's people to Moab. And Moab was a place where God, the God of the Bible, was not worshipped. They worshipped false gods. They didn't want the teachings of the Bible. They, like the people of Israel, did what was right in their own eyes. But when they get to the land, Elimelech dies, Mahlon and Chilion die, and Naomi, the wife, is left with her two daughters-in-law, Orpah and Ruth. And she tells them to go back to Moab. And it says that Orpah did, but that Ruth clung to her. And Ruth makes this statement in Ruth chapter 1, verse 16. She says, "Where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God." And so Naomi figures out that in a time of desperation, she has lost her husband, she has lost her two sons, and she hears in the fields of Moab that God has visited Bethlehem and provided food after 10 years. So she spends a decade in Moab, and the decision to move to Moab has literally killed her family, and she is desperate. And I don't know if you've ever been here this morning or been there, but Naomi literally has only one option. The only option that she has is that she can return to God, that she can return to God's place and God's presence and God's people. Anytime that you move away from God's place, God's presence, and God's people, ruin happens. And that's what had happened to her family. And so she makes a decision to make the week-long walk. She didn't have a car that she could jump in, but she makes this week-long journey to go back to Bethlehem. And Ruth, her daughter-in-law, says, "I'm going to go with you. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." And so they get back. They're poor and destitute and widows, and they are desperate. And they're impoverished. They have nowhere else to go but back to God and back to his people. And so they get back to Bethlehem, and which literally means the house of bread is what the word Bethlehem means. They get back to Bethlehem, and in chapter 2, God's law had provided for people to glean in the fields, for poor people to be able to go behind the reapers and the harvesters and to be able to glean food so that they would not die. Today we would think about maybe WIC or food stamps or going to a food bank. But in that time, you had to work to be able to get that. And so Ruth goes out. She starts gleaning. And she just happens to end up in a field of a man named Boaz. And we're told that Boaz is a redeemer. He's probably a cousin of Elimelech, and that he's someone that may be able to help them. And Boaz shows incredible kindness to Ruth, despite her being a Moabite and someone that was looked down upon. She was a poor widow that was a Moabite, and Boaz is a wealthy Israelite, and he treats her with incredible kindness and provides for her and for Naomi during the harvest season. And so she worked in his fields for the harvest throughout the barley harvest and the wheat harvest. And we come to chapter 3, which was last week. And Naomi, look at chapter 3, verse 1, says that Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to Ruth, "My daughter, should I not seek rest for you?" Or some translations say, "a home for you, that it may be well with you." So Naomi wants to find rest for Ruth. She doesn't want Ruth just skimping by and just barely being able to feed them, but she wants a lasting solution. She loves Ruth and wants what's best for her. And so she comes up with this plan and tells Ruth to go down to the threshing floor where Boaz is and to basically to propose to Boaz, to ask Boaz to be her redeemer. And so she goes down and she does this. She's obedient. She puts herself in harm's way. She goes down to the threshing floor and she lays down at Boaz's feet. And in the middle of the night, Boaz wakes up and he says, "Whoa, who's here?" And Ruth says, it's me, Ruth. She basically says, "I want you to be my redeemer." And so Ruth says in chapter 3, verse 11, he says, "My daughter, do not fear. I will do all that you ask for you, for all my fellow townsmen know that you are a worthy woman." But then he says this, and he says, "It is true that I am a redeemer, yet there is a redeemer nearer than I." And so Ruth follows Naomi's plan. She is asking Boaz to redeem her, but there's a problem. Boaz is not the next relative in line. There is a redeemer. There's someone in between him and Elimelech. There's a closer relative to Elimelech than him. But he says at the end of chapter 3, Naomi says to Ruth, she says, "Wait, my daughter, until you learn how the matter turns out, for the man will not rest, but will settle the matter today." So we pick up the story in Ruth chapter 4 that Boaz, it seems that every love story, if you watch any kind of a movie, a romance movie, I don't watch a lot of those, but Bethany's turned me on to a couple of them. One of them is Pride and Prejudice. She loves that, so we watch that, you know, about once a year or so. But in every love story, there's always some kind of foil. There's always some kind of conflict. And here we have Boaz has said, I will marry you. Ruth wants to be redeemed, and yet there's a closer relative. And so how will this story turn out? And that's where we come to in Ruth chapter 4. And what I want us to see this morning, our sermon title is that a redeemer changes everything. A redeemer changes everything. And the big idea, if you have your bulletin, is that through the work of a redeemer, God changes our past failures and our past pain into a promising future. Or maybe even your present failures or your present pain into a promising future. Look at Ruth chapter 4, verses 1 through 12. Let's read that together. It says, "Now Boaz had gone up to the gate and sat down there. And behold, the redeemer of whom Boaz had spoken came by. So Boaz said, 'Turn aside, friend, sit down here.' And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, 'Sit down here.' So they sat down. Then he said to the redeemer, 'Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, is selling the parcel of land that belonged to our relative Elimelech. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, buy in the presence of these sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not, tell me that I may know. For there is no one besides you to redeem it, and I come after you.' And he said, 'I will redeem it.' Then Boaz said, 'The day you buy the field from the hand of Naomi, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance.' Then the redeemer said, 'I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it.' Now this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging. To confirm a transaction, the one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other. And this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the Redeemer said to Boaz, "Buy it for yourself," he drew off his sandal. Then Boaz said to the elders and to all the people, "You are witnesses this day that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion and to Mahlon. Also Ruth the Moabite, the widow of Mahlon, I have bought to be my wife, to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of his native place. You are witnesses this day." Then all the people who were at the gate and the elders said, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. May you act worthily in Ephrathah and be renowned in Bethlehem. And may your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, because of the offspring that the Lord will give you by this young woman." So the first thing I want us to see this morning is that through the work of a Redeemer, we have an inheritance. Through the work of a Redeemer, we have an inheritance. So what happens? Boaz goes up to the city gate, verse 1 it says, and he went up to the gate, and it says that he sat down. Well, the city gate is where you would do business transactions in ancient Israel. So business transactions, legal proceedings. So today we might think of the Chamber of Commerce or the courthouse. Basically, if you combine the Chamber of Commerce and the courthouse and you're able to go to the same place, that's where you would do this. Or even the DMV. If you need to get your license renewed, you would go to the city gate, right? So if you had to get a license to ride your camel around, no, I'm just kidding. But if you were going to the city gate, that's where you would find the mayor. That's where you would find the city council. That's where you would find judges. That's where you went to do business. And archaeologists have found benches literally by city gates and in ancient towns. And when you sat down at that bench, that was the position of doing business. And so we see that here. Boaz comes to the city gate, and it says in verse 1 that the other redeemer, the nearer of kin to Elimelech, comes by. And he says, "Turn aside, friend." And notice that the other redeemer is never named. That word for friend really just is generic and almost means so-and-so. "Turn aside, come over here, Mr. So-and-so." Or, "Come over here, buddy." "Come over here, man." "Come over here, dude." He says, "Come over here." He says, "Sit down." And then he explains the situation. Now the elders, these were not all necessarily old men, but they were men of a certain age that helped administrate the affairs of the community. They had significant life experience, and they knew God's law. They knew what was supposed to be done, and they helped make decisions for the community. And so Boaz, in verse 3, he reveals the situation. He says, "Naomi has come back from the country of Moab, and she's selling her land that belonged to Elimelech." And so you may be wondering, well, hey, why are they so poor if she is a landowner, right? It says that Naomi is selling her land. Well, she's not technically a landowner. Look at on the screen at Numbers chapter 27. It says, "And you shall speak to the people of Israel, saying, if a man dies and has no son, then you shall transfer his inheritance to his daughter. And if he has no daughter, then you shall give his inheritance to his brothers. And if he has no brothers, then you shall give his inheritance to his father's brothers. And if his father has no brothers, then you shall give his inheritance to the nearest kinsman of his clan, and he shall possess it. And it shall be for the people of Israel a statute and rule, as the Lord commanded Moses." So that's what's happening. So sometimes you read Leviticus, you read Numbers, and you're like, or you read Deuteronomy, and you think, okay, what in the world does that stuff mean? Well, here's a concrete example of Numbers chapter 27, verses 8 through 11, that happens right here in the book of Ruth. See, the people of Israel, they lived out this stuff. They were to obey these laws. God had put these laws into place to care for His people. And so Boaz is saying that the land that needs to be tra- that the land that Naomi has is to be transferred to the nearest of kin. And he's saying, Mr. So-and-so, hey, dude, you're it. So you need to redeem it. You need to, either you need to buy the land or I'm next in line. He's saying, you need to take up and be Naomi's redeemer. So there's three qualifications of a redeemer if you want to look on your bulletin. Three qualifications of a redeemer, or sometimes this is called a kinsman redeemer. You have to be a blood relative. You have to have sufficient resources to be able to care for the people that you're redeeming. And you have to have a willingness to buy. A blood relative, sufficient resources, a willingness to buy. And notice what happens in verse 4. The man says, I will redeem it. And at this point, for him, it's a really good transaction. He gets some free land. He's not really buying it. It's really just coming to him through the law. So he's getting some free land, and all he has to do is basically provide for Naomi. Naomi's an older woman. All he has to do is just basically get her land and then provide for her the rest of her days until she dies. So basically, for the cost of another mouth to feed, he gets some free land for him, and then that will pass on to his sons and his daughters later on. And so it's a good business transaction. Hey, I get some, who wouldn't want some free land? Who wouldn't, today in our society, who wouldn't mind paying some groceries for somebody for the rest of their life if you got a free parcel of land that you got to keep forever? So it sounds really good. And then, as reveals the catch, he says, the day that you buy the field, verse 5, you also acquire Ruth the Moabite, the widow of the dead, in order to perpetuate the name of the dead in his inheritance. And then the Redeemer said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it. So if you have your bulletin again, there's three responsibilities of a kinsman redeemer. There's more than this, but for our purposes, these three. The first is to marry the widow and to provide for her. So this redeemer was to marry Naomi, or in this case, Ruth, but to marry the widow and to provide for her. To take the land and to protect the family line by providing an heir for the estate. Look at on the screen, Deuteronomy chapter 25. It says, if brothers dwell together and one of them dies and has no son, the wife of the dead man shall not be married outside the family to a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go into her and take her as his wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. And the first son whom she bears shall succeed to the name of his dead brother, that his name may not be blotted out in Israel. So that's exactly what has happened. The game has changed. Now all of a sudden the transaction goes from just marrying, taking Naomi into the family and providing for her, and now the Redeemer, this kinsman, will have to marry Ruth, who is a Moabite. And remember, what is Boaz so far? What has he called Ruth twice? My daughter in chapter 2 and my daughter in chapter 3. But here, when he comes to a business transaction, he says, you're going to have to marry Ruth the Moabite. And the guy's like, So I've got a Moabite that I'm going to have to take care of, and Naomi. And so, but not only that, but he's responsible for, through this passage of Deuteronomy, he's also got to raise up a son. He's supposed to have a child with Ruth and raise up a son, and then that son will then take over that estate. So now the deal doesn't sound so good, because now he's not getting just free land. He's taking care of Naomi, he's taking care of Ruth, and he's taking care of the children that him and Ruth have, and that child, that oldest son, will now get the estate. And so what does he say? He says, this redemption I cannot do. It's too costly. It's too costly. If I do it, what does he say? Then I will impair my own inheritance. It's really a sensible thing. He loves his children, so he doesn't want his children to have to split the inheritance more. He wants them to be well provided for. But he says, basically, the redemption is too costly. What if Jesus would have said that about us? What if when God sent Jesus to come and to die for our sins, what if Jesus would have said, it's too costly? What if he would have said, do you remember when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he prays to the Father and he says, if there's any other way, God, take this cup from me, but if it's your will, thy will be done. What if Jesus in that moment, what if in Matthew chapter 4 when Satan tempts Jesus three times and says, I'll give you all the things of this world, what if Jesus would have said, it's too costly for me to deny myself. It's too costly. It's too costly. But Jesus doesn't do that. And look what Boaz does. He basically tells the elders and tells everybody sitting there, he says, I will redeem it. I will take care of Naomi. I will take care of Ruth. In a time when everyone did what is right in his own eyes, Boaz is a man that loves God, that fears God, and that is willing to care for Naomi and Ruth, the poorest of the poor and the destitute of the destitute. And so they do this transaction. The other redeemer raises up his sandal. I'm not going to do that. I don't want to knock anybody out on the front row. But he raises his sandal, raises his shoe, and he gives it to Boaz. And commentators think that it basically represents, hey, that I'm going to take over. You've heard that saying, walk a mile in their shoes. Well, Boaz is about to take this other redeemer's shoe, and he said, I'm going to take the place of where you were supposed to go. I'm going to take over. I'm going to redeem Naomi. I'm going to redeem Ruth. And so he's willing to take on this responsibility to not just care for them, but to also continue the land and the inheritance of Elimelech. The first child that him and Ruth have will be the heir to Elimelech's estate. So he's going to buy this land, he's going to take care of them, but he's really going to continue the family line of Elimelech before his own. In verses 11 and 12, the elders of the city, they pronounce a blessing on Boaz. And they say in verse 11, may the Lord make this woman who is coming into your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. So if you remember, Rachel and Leah were married to Jacob, and Jacob was later named Israel. And through them, through Rachel and Leah and each of their servants, there was 12 sons, the 12 tribes of Israel. And so these men are praying for, they're pronouncing a blessing on Boaz and saying, may Ruth be like these women. And that's just amazing because Ruth is a Moabite. And they're saying, may this Moabite, this woman that you are redeeming, may she become like the matriarchs of Israel, like Rachel and Leah. And it says in verse 11, it says, who together built up the name of Israel, may you act worthily in Ephrathah and be renowned in Bethlehem. They were Ephrathites. That's a hard word to say. But Boaz and Elimelech and this unnamed redeemer, they were in the clan of the Ephrathites. My goodness. Ephrathites. That's why we don't have clans anymore, because we can't pronounce them, right? That's why when you go to a family reunion, you can't remember everybody's name. Can you imagine? Hey, fellow Ephrathite, glad you're here. They say, may you act worthily. In other words, you're acting in a worthy manner. You are taking up the call. You are making the sacrifices that you need to make. May you be built up. And as far as we know, Boaz right now is a single man. We don't know that he has any family. The text doesn't say that he has any. And they're saying, may this woman that's coming into your house, may she build up your house like Rachel and Leah built up the house of Jacob. And it says, and may your house be the house like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, because of the offspring that the Lord will give you by this young woman. You can go back to Genesis 38, and Judah and Tamar, it was a similar situation you can just go back and look at it. But the circumstances that Boaz and Ruth have, it's a similar situation with Judah and Tamar. And so through the work of a redeemer, we have an inheritance. Ruth and Naomi now have something to look forward to. They have a redeemer. They have someone to care for them. And there's the possibility that a redeemer, that an heir will come forward. So through the work of a redeemer, we have an inheritance, but we also have a family. We have a family. Look at verses 13 through 17. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And he went into her. And the Lord gave her conception. And then 9 months later, she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer. And may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than 7 sons, has given birth to him." Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse. And the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. So in one verse in chapter 13, all the problems of chapter 1 go right away. That doesn't mean that they, of course, Naomi still misses Elimelech. She misses Mahlon and Chilion. And Ruth misses her husband Mahlon. But in one verse, Ruth, who was husbandless, now has a husband. Ruth, who had been barren, had not been able to have a child with Mahlon, is granted conception. And Ruth and Naomi, who had no son that would be able to take care of them in their old age, now they have a son and a grandson. Only twice in the book of Ruth is God explicitly to be the cause of actions. In chapter 1, verse 6, it says that the Lord provided food in Bethlehem. And here it says that the Lord gave her conception. Boaz is an older man. Perhaps he wouldn't have been able to have a child here without the Lord's help, obviously. And she had been married to Mahlon for possibly as much as 10 years and never had a child. And so now you put those two together and it says the Lord gave her conception. Whenever they were in Moab, whenever they were away from God's place, away from God's presence, and away from God's people, they were in spiritual ruin and desperation. And when they came back, God starts working. God provides. Ruth is resilient. She goes to work. She finds favor with Boaz, and Boaz is generous. And God brings them together as only He can do. And it says in verse 14 that the women say to Naomi, these are the same women that said to Naomi when she came into town, "Naomi's here with the Moabite," and what did Naomi tell them? "Don't call me Naomi anymore, call me bitter." And the same ladies say here today, or 9 months, or however many, probably about a year later, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a redeemer." That redeemer is not Boaz, that redeemer is Obed. They're saying, the Lord has not left you without a redeemer. The Lord has given you a grandson. Even though your sons are dead, now you've got a grandson that can continue your family line. That even though Elimelech's dead, his name will live on through Obed. And they said, "May his name be renowned in Israel, and how prophetic that was, because this very son, Obed, was the grandfather of King David, the most famous king in all of Israel. A young guardian redeemer, a kinsman redeemer, is born for Naomi, who will grow and protect her family and inheritance. And verse 16 is an easy verse to read and skip over, unless you're a grandma, I guess. But it says, "Then Naomi took the child and laid him on her lap and became his nurse." Can you imagine the pain that Naomi has gone through? Her family left her in a famine. Her husband died. She buried her husband. She buried her 2 sons in Moab, not even with the people of Israel, but buried them in a place, a spiritually destitute place. She buries them, and she leaves them, and she comes back hopeless and destitute. And now, through the work of a redeemer, now she is holding her own grandson that will basically continue her dead husband's family line. And that she's going to be taken care of in her old age, and that Ruth is going to be taken care of, and that this home, this rest that she prayed for Ruth in chapter 3, verse 1, is coming to fruition. For you grandmas, and maybe even grandpas, you can appreciate these words. You can appreciate how much fun you have with your grandchildren, I hope. But can you imagine if you'd had a grandchild after all this, after all that? You talk about an answer to prayer. When she was coming back to Israel, she was just hoping to eat, to be able to not die. And now, not only is she well cared for, but now she has a grandson to help raise. What a beautiful picture. Burying a child is arguably the hardest thing to do in this life. But on the flip side, the birth of a child brings more joy than anything else. The book of Ruth begins with the death of a man and his two sons, and it ends with the joy of new birth. The book of Ruth takes us from death to life, from devastation to joy, and from despair to hope. So through the work of a Redeemer, we have a family. And then lastly, through the work of a Redeemer, we have a future. Look at verses 18 through 22. Now these are the generations of Perez. Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Ram. Ram fathered Amminadab. Amminadab fathered Nahshon. Nahshon fathered Salmon. Salmon fathered Boaz. Boaz fathered Obed. Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered David. During a period when many people did what was right in their own eyes, there were at least three people that did what was right in God's eyes: Boaz, Ruth, and Naomi. God worked through Boaz to redeem not just Ruth and Naomi, but to bring about David, the greatest king of Israel. The same godliness that guided Boaz to bless Naomi and Ruth was the same godliness and kindness that guided David to bless his nation and redeem Israel from the moral chaos of the judges. Think about where Ruth is in the Bible. Right after Judges, in a time when everybody did what was right in his own eyes, and 1 Samuel, which is where the monarchy, the kingship, is established. So Saul and then David. But Boaz and Ruth are the chain that goes from moral chaos to the greatest king in Israel. The book of Ruth. God was doing far more than Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz could have realized during their lifetimes. God worked through Boaz to redeem not just Ruth and Naomi, but to bring about not only the greatest king of Israel, King David, but also to bring about King Jesus. We're not going to turn there, but in Matthew chapter 1, this same genealogy that we see right here with Perez, starts with Perez, it goes back to Judah, and it goes back to Abraham. And through Abraham, Judah, Perez, and the same genealogy, if you get down to the bottom name, it was Jesus. Through the generosity of Boaz, through the kindness of Boaz, and through the faithfulness of him and Naomi and Ruth, through that, God brings about Jesus. How did the book of Ruth start? Moral chaos, famine, funerals, incredible pain, and desperation. That's how the book started. And Naomi and Ruth experienced incredible pain, incredible hardships. And Naomi said, "Don't even call me Naomi, call me bitter." But God in His goodness and through the kindness of a Redeemer gives Naomi and Ruth provision, protection, an inheritance, a family, joy, and a future. And how did that happen? For Ruth, it meant turning to the one true God. She used to be a Moabite, but then she said, "Your God will be my God." She turned to God. For Naomi, it meant returning to God. She went to Moab. She went away from God's people. And she was living for material things. And then she goes back to the one true God. And together, they go back to God's place to be with God's people and to experience God's presence. But things really only changed when what? When they came face to face with a Redeemer. And during our lives, God lets us go through trials and to show us the depths of our need so that He can show us the fullness of His provision. This morning, I don't know what you're going through. The pain of loss, the pain of a bad diagnosis, the pain of strained relationships, the sadness over your sinful past and your past failures, or maybe your present failures. I don't know what it is. But this morning, I want you to know that through the work of a Redeemer, that God can change that. Those past failures, those present failures, the past pain, the present pain into a promising future. And Boaz, the kinsman redeemer of Naomi and Ruth, points to our great redeemer, Jesus Christ. There's three qualifications of a redeemer back on your bulletin. They have to be a blood relative, the redeemer. Did you know Jesus is our blood relative? The eternal Son of God was born of a woman and he became a man. Galatians 4 and 5 says that when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. Does Jesus have sufficient resources? I think he does. 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19 says that we were not purchased, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Jesus was willing to pay the penalty for our sins, and he had the necessary resources because he was perfectly obedient. He was 100% God, 100% man, and he made a bridge, he made a way. And Jesus had a willingness to buy. Mark 10:45 says, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Through Jesus, God's own Son, not only do we have forgiveness of sins, but we have a spiritual inheritance. We get the righteousness of Christ, and we get spiritual blessings. And Romans 8 says that we are co-heirs with Christ. We have an inheritance. We have a family. I don't know what the state of your family is this morning, but in Christ, you have a family. You have the church. You have people that love you and care for you, and like Boaz, will not let you starve to death, but that will care for you and love you. Even in your time of desperation, the church is here to be your family. And lastly, we have a future with God forever. A future with God forever. And in Ruth chapter 1, verse 16, Ruth said, "Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." Look on the screen at Revelation 21. "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.'" This morning, maybe you're spiritually, physically, maybe you're in every way desperate like Ruth and Naomi. What you need this morning is a redeemer. And if you have that redeemer, if you have Jesus, if you will turn from your sin and put your faith in Jesus and what he has done on the cross, then that's your future. A future where God will be your God, we will be his people, and there will be no more crying. And that's the story of Ruth, and it's the story of the Bible. And if that doesn't make you about tear up, then I don't know what does. But let's go ahead and stand.